We're looking at the question of the future and our attitudes to the future, and this session is called Utopia, Myopia, and it's particularly going to focus on contemporary discussions about the future. There's a kind of anxiety about the fact that we're so negative about future visions in contemporary society. That's the assumption. You can work out what you think about that based on our speakers. I was having a discussion with a woman in the toilet about the Barbican, the usual discussion you have about not being able to find your way around, and I told her that I loved the building, and she asked me to explain why, so the discussion went on for a bit. Mainly I love it because of the detail, but I also, of course, love it because it's very ambitious, and it's one of the few places that you come to in London where you get an overwhelming sense of some people engaged in the design of the place who have a very strong sense of what life might be like, a better life. And whatever else has happened socially between the conception of it and now, it's still there. It resides in the building. So part of the discussion today is going to look at the relationship between social ambition and the things that we create in order to house that social ambition and how things change over time. We've got a great panel of people who are very well qualified to talk on this subject. The first speaker would have been Jonathan Glancy, but the problems of the southern infrastructure means that he's not able to be with us here, which is ironic given that he's an expert on transport. You'd think he'd have known, actually, how bad the state of play is. Jonathan's not able to be here, but I have a statement from him, which I'm going to read at the beginning. He is an architectural journalist. He was, most of you will probably know him as the architectural correspondent for The Guardian, and prior to that, for The Independent. And now he writes for The Daily Telegraph and writes for the BBC and is the author of a number of books. The first speaker who will be here with us in present bodily is Alastair Donald. He's Associate Director of the Future Cities Project and was the producer of this session. He's also the Architecture Programme Manager at the British Council. The second speaker is Manon Mollard, who is an architectural designer and writer, and she studied at the Architectural Association in London and has worked in Columbia. And then presently, she's the features editor of the Architectural Review. And the final speaker is Sir Nicholas Kenyon, who I suppose is our host.
It's all my fault.
It's all your fault. Sir Nicholas became the managing director of the Barbican in October 2007. He's also been controller of BBC Radio 3 and director of the BBC Proms. But obviously, as our host for today, he has a very great insight into the way in which the Barbican functions in particular. But probably you will have heard his Radio 4 programme, Cities from the Ashes, which was an exploration of exactly the same questions that we're going to be looking at today, our attitudes towards the city, and particularly how our attitudes towards the city has changed in the post-war period up to contemporary times. Okay, so forgive me, but I am going to impersonate Jonathan Glancy for a few seconds. Just imagine I'm Jonathan. Now, ladies and gentlemen, just as the gates at the entrance to Bank Station were opened, behold, the city shone like the sun. The streets were paved with gold, and in them walked many men with sunglasses on their heads, smartphones in their hands, and personal stereos ringing rap and roll. Above there were gleaming towers, so many I was unable to count. Their shapes were trapezoidal, parallelograms, and paraboloid hyperbole. I think he did this on purpose, just to give me a hard time. And their names were the mustard pot, the onion, the banana, the mockery, and the discarded tin can. I had seen the celestial city, a capitalist utopia, shaped by the free market, through which we were all to be middle class, sport, Tony Blair, permatans, and history would have come to an end. This blue sky utopia thinking has, though given us, outside this Barbican, a city of London skyline no longer worthy, no longer worth having, robbed of history, culture, planning, grace, and character, like so many cities worldwide affected by the same thinking. Nowhere places. such as the utopia and utopian thinking applied to architecture and cities. Much the same is true of socialist utopias, from the mild, like Britain's post-war new towns, to the disturbingly serious, like Stalin's workers' paradises stretched across the steppes of Siberia, much praised by Lenin's useful idiots from countries like our own. Even today, there are MPs at Westminster who believe that, on the whole, the mass murderer Mao Zedong did more good than harm in his proletarian utopia. Utopian thinking has its place, and at the edge can be a force for good. Think of Frank Pick and London Transport. But like Shambhala, El Dorado, Shangri-La, and medieval kingdom of Prester John, it is best kept to dreams and fairy tales. Even then, there are stoats and weasels in Wind of the Willows, goblins in Toy Town, and wicked witches in Oz. There is, though, a place for longing, for progress and reform, and yes, utopian thinking. Here in London, as elsewhere in the world, I can tell you, for example, of another country I heard of long ago. I'm now going to read a piece of poetry that he's put in here. Most dear to them that love her, most great to them that know her, we may not count her armies, we may not see her king. Her fortress is a faithful heart, her pride is suffering. And soul by soul and silently, her shining bounds increase. And her ways are ways of gentleness, and all her paths are peace. That is utopia. It can't be found in this world, and might not even be there for us in the next, thank God. Okay, round of applause for Jonathan. Alistair.
Okay, I suspect I'm going to be a little bit less poetic than that. On the question of utopian thinking, I feel a bit torn. I find that I want to have my cake, but also to keep it too. And I suppose that's appropriate, really, given utopia is renowned as being simultaneously utopos, good place, but also utopos, meaning no place at all. And I kind of feel a little bit drawn to two seemingly incompatible positions, because on the one hand, I think the recent revival of utopia is such a kind of debased form of utopian thinking that it's now more or less a problem for anybody who's interested in developing a kind of more dynamic, positively future-orientated approach to creating the future. But at the same time, you know, I recognize that in utopianism, there's a long and quite productive tradition. I think in many ways, recovering something of that kind of imaginative approach to the future would be a good thing that we could benefit from. So I'm sort of here to bury utopia, but also to defend it as well. And in my conclusions, I'll try and square that circle a little bit. So firstly, in defense of utopia. Well, I think it's worth remembering that from Thomas More's time onwards, the vision of utopians and the literary, artistic, and architectural works that they often created, they embodied a very positive sense of aspiration for change. And from today's vantage point, where we live in a world that has little sense that the future could be a better place, then that's a good thing. It's also worth remembering, and Moore is a classic example of this, I think, that the utopias didn't just imagine the future, but they often embodied a critique of the present. So, for example, within Moore, that meant taking a pop at the laws and customs and circumstances of the day, the harsh punishment of offenders, high prices, the changes that were going on that caused worklessness, the rise of mercenaries, and so on and so forth. So again, there's this kind of critical element to utopias, at least some of them. And it was on the back of this combination of critique and imagination that the utopians were able to portray their enticing visions. And again, at a time like today when in many ways the operation of society is naturalized and portrayed as beyond human control, the utopian tradition, I think, could offer us something useful. It's a reminder that in the past people had a kind of belief that conventional arrangements that held us back, whether they be monarchs or landowners or the market system or whatever, these arrangements could be dissolved and replaced with something new and better. And I kind of like the way that utopians offered a glimpse into the world that could be created according to human desires. Again, something that's largely absent today. And in the visions of people like Bacon and Fourier and Wells, there was that sense of a freer space that existed beyond where they were, one where human passions, I suppose, could be directed to productive ends, where people could become educated. They could have a choice of jobs rather than the jobs that they were bound to, of hobbies and pursuits, pursuing even artistic ambitions. William Morris, I think, put it nicely, that life could feel very different. But having defended utopia, let me give three quick examples of that suggest why the more recent tradition of utopian thinking has become less useful, and I think actually increasingly problematic. So firstly, starting in the 1960s, utopia seemed to change from an imaginative model that could be present a vision that could transform society into something that merely offered an escape from the existing situation. You've only got to think of people like Guy Debord and his artistic collaborator Constant Nieuwenhuis, who created situations where they merely drifted around the city, effectively ignoring the current reality. It provided a kind of alternative for a few people that were lucky enough to be able to do that. Or Paolo Soleri's Arcosanti, which ended up as a kind of small hippie village retreat in the desert. Or even the kind of ideas of escaping to space and colonies in space, which were an escape from the kind of hell of the ecological crisis below. And instead of, I think, presenting new models for changing wider society, what these escapist utopias seemed to do was, in effect, offer a parallel world for some people to get out of the things that they didn't like, which I think is not really the original spirit of utopia. Secondly, then, there's the dystopianism that's dominated the last 20 or 30 years. And here, even the prospect of escape is not really offered. It's kind of entirely society becoming engulfed in the perceived horror story of modernity. It's not to say that dystopian works haven't thrown up some interesting things, but I think recently, if you take things like the ruin porn approach to, say, Detroit, or the kind of fascination with deserted atomic cities in the Soviet Union, it's really a utopia that is held up and used very much to serve as a warning against trying to create a better future. These kind of dystopias are often presented, I think, as quite radical, but when you think about the way that even Pentagon planners today, for example, use these kind of dystopian scenarios as part of their strategic planning, then I think you see how mainstream and kind of not necessarily progressive that they become. And finally, the latest trend, what the writer Davina Cooper calls everyday utopias. And these utopias create what are billed as, and just to quote her, refreshingly small-scale real-world alternatives to the grand visions and rigid future blueprints of the past. But you see these type of projects, and she gives a few examples. She features about six examples in her book, and just to read a couple of them. One of them is a UK government initiative to expand quality by various non-physical forms of touching citizens. That's one of her examples. Or women-only bathhouses to make women feel more comfortable with their bodies. So these kind of these everyday utopias, which arguably are really just kind of fiddling around with mainstream social policy initiatives, are I think a reflection of the collapsing confidence of something a bit more transformative. So to conclude, how do you kind of square the circle of kind of a belief in utopian thinking being a good thing, but also recognizing the problems? Well, it seems to me that the trick here is to focus not just on what the utopian thinkers and artists, et cetera, are doing, but to look at the wider political, social, cultural reality of the world that they're operating in. And I think if you look to the kind of escapist dystopian utopias that I mentioned, then they emerged very much at a time when there was a growing sense that the promise of a better future, 1960s this was kind of not really materializing, whether that be environmental breakdown or the kind of fashionable theories that were starting to emerge of overpopulation or nuclear annihilation or so on and so forth. So these were, I suppose, utopias that were rooted in a period of political demoralization rather than enthusiasm for change. And likewise, the everyday utopias of today, I think they're occurring amidst a time when there's a fair amount of doom. There's a rather desperate sense just now that, you know, with all the dystopian ideas, we need to be a little bit more positive. So the everyday utopias have come a way of clinging on to a little bit of optimism about the world. But this is kind of really a happy-clappy kind of well-being type of utopia that I don't think is offering much in any sort of transformative sense. So for me, a more worthwhile utopianism, to recover a sense of a more worthwhile utopian, I think requires us, first of all, to recover a more critical engagement with contemporary society, one that starts and endeavours to understand a little bit more about how we can transcend the perceived constraints and limits that are placed on human activity today. The best utopias, I think, very much date from times when the imagination was starting to stretch a little bit because radicals and intellectuals and cultural figures were drawing energy from their times. I mean, you only need to think of Thomas More again, for example, coming on the back of the Renaissance humanism, of explorers setting out to discover the new world. It very much anticipates modernity and kind of operates on the basis that we can expand our world into something newer, better. So I think to make the imagination of the future a more worthwhile exercise, we should really ditch the escapist and everyday utopias and instead rehabilitate a belief that we as human beings could become masters of our own destiny.
So as Alistair pointed out, depending on the prefix, utopia is either non-place or right place or good place. And really, I think the idea is that it's both. The idea is that it is a right place or a good place, but we shouldn't really get there. So yes, it might be a kind of will or an idea to change the world and to shape it according to our desires, but the reality, both kind of sadly and happily, will actually curb these absolute desires and impact it, which is why the original utopia is not really achieved. So I think in the kind of in the recent history, the most significant utopian urban projects were in this chunk in the middle of the 20th century, which saw the futurists Le Corbusier, Constant, even Jona Friedman, Archie Graham, Archie Zun, etc. And a lot of these urban utopias were kind of designed and imagined until there was a moment in 1972 when the housing complex of Proetago was demolished, which, as Charles Zenk said, was kind of the death of modern architecture. That didn't stop us, in a way, from imagining better tomorrows or being sort of optimistic about the future of the city. And instead of being kind of designing actual urban plans, it converted into kind of theory or books about reflecting on the kind of the nature of the city. So there was Colin Rowe, Jane Jacobs, Venturi and Scott Brown, Rem Koolhaas. And so at the time, we were thinking about the city in a kind of very idealistic way. We saw it as a tool of emancipation for people. And in a way, urban planning came hand in hand with a kind of a social and a political vision. And today, well, this period, this chunk of the 20th century, kind of is roughly between the outbreak of World War I and 1989, which is the fall of the Berlin Wall. And if we put it in parallel with Thomas Piketty's Capital, it apparently is the only moment in history where the kind of the return on labor outdid the actual return on capital. So in a way, by working hard, you could get further than by just actually having money. So the relation between architects and planners designing these worlds and this kind of economic situation is, I think, worth noting and discussing. And so today, after 1989, the world isn't divided anymore according to ideology, but rather there is sort of a kind of a common consensus, which is money. And so urban planning as a public project, it's conceived and implemented by the government and intended for the public good, no longer exists. Instead, we have a kind of a project that's undertaken by private enterprises whose motivation remains first and foremost profit. So rather than being mechanisms of social democracy, cities have become instruments of the market. And social engagement has kind of diminished. So today we measure cities in terms of performance. We kind of have rankings of livable cities, you know, Vancouver and Melbourne. But we've lost sort of a bit of real content, a bit of vision. And it seems that the only kind of alternative that we found is sort of sustainability, which I don't think it's got kind of any ideological content. It doesn't offer a vision. But, you know, we still want to make the world better, so we have to kind of come up with something. The problem with something like sustainability is that it's just a technological issue, and it can be solved purely through kind of engineering. So it doesn't actually propose anything. It doesn't have a social political position. It feels a bit hollow. And even if the project that we design today and tomorrow have, you know, a zero carbon billing and whatever, the only achievement is that they're not making the world worse, but really they're not actually doing anything else. And so the, you know, that photograph of Le Corbusier with his hand above his Ville Radieuse was speaking about the kind of really powerful potential relationship between the creator, the architect, and the project, and setting the architect as a kind of a powerful visionary. And that hand somehow is still there. The problem is that it's the hand of the market, and that the kind of forces shaping the built environment are self-interest, competition, supply, and demand. So in a way, there's less and less architecture. And of course, we know that, you know, the yes, some of those schemes in the 60s were kind of driven by escapism, and some of the other ones had terrible kind of consequences. It wasn't all good, in a way, with the kind of utopian urban visions of the mid-20th century. But somehow, they were trying to do something. And I think you could argue that even if the modernist legacy is a lot of failed social projects, they were at least trying to do something, and it's better to kind of, there's less shame in a failed project than there is in kind of not even trying to mobilize every possible endeavor to try and achieve something. And you could also argue that the makers of these utopians were probably quite arrogant, and but I think we're still arrogant today, so really that's not an excuse either. So I think you can adhere or we can reject a utopia, but it doesn't leave anyone indifferent. And I feel like the lack of utopian vision is problematic, because the architectural profession feels too safe. We let kind of developers in the construction in other industries, technology in the automobile industries and the smart cities, kind of take decisions about the built environment. And as architects, we're sort of kind of just stuck in the present and not offering any alternative.
Thanks, Penny. Well, as you will gather, I am not the expert on this panel, but as a curator of the Barbican, as it presently is, I do have a certain responsibility. Let me start from the position that utopia and cities are totally opposed as concepts. Utopia requires a forward-looking vision, and I would have thought a blank sheet of paper to start from. Cities are intrinsically messy, organic, develop in a modelled and not necessarily a controlled way. Are there any examples where utopia and cities do come together? Well, I think it's worth looking back. This year we have been marking, you probably are aware, 350 years since the Great Fire of London, which completely destroyed so much of the area in the square mile of the city, including old St. Paul's Cathedral. And a very interesting thing happened in the wake of that, which was that given that streets and houses and buildings had been destroyed, there was a real sense of vision among some of the architects of the time that the City of London could be recreated on a wholly new model. You could have wide boulevards, you could have squares, you could have different ways for people to move around. And those designs were exhibited at Reba earlier in the year. They're really worth having a look at. Why did that not happen? It didn't happen because of the essential practical problem of land ownership and the essential conservatism of people who wanted, albeit with better materials, to rebuild their houses exactly where they were and the way they were. And the amount of compensation that would have been involved in buying people out of that land and starting from scratch, as Wren and Hooke and others wanted, simply was not feasible. And so what happened, as you can see if you walk around the square mile of the city today, is that very largely it was built, rebuilt in a non-utopian way. It was rebuilt on the old street pattern, but with far better materials. And there are some people who would argue that actually the London Building Acts, which were a consequence of the city burning down, about materials, about how you built buildings, were an extremely positive outcome of that trauma of the Great Fire. And the only reason I'm going on about that is because there is a very vivid, very obvious contrast, which is a part of a city which was rebuilt according to a utopian vision, and that is where we're sitting now. Because the Blitz in the Second World War did not succeed in destroying New St. Paul's, which you can just see out of the window there, but it did succeed in destroying a whole area in this northwest of the city. There were some survivals. St. Giles's Church, just across the lake there, was bombed but was repairable. The Whitbread Brewery, now a famous conference centre, survived because it had its own fire engine. But the rest of this area of the city was completely demolished. Now, the same non-utopian approach could have been taken by the city at that point. But, and this is, I think, where it relates to what both of you were saying very vividly, the Second World War and that immediate post-war period was a period of great aspiration and, I would say, utopianism in the whole area of town planning. And people felt that you could do better. People felt that you should make a fresh start. And so a long conversation went on here in the city about how to deal with this whole area. And in the end, well, the Barbican took about 10 years to think out, 10 years to plan, and 10 years to build, so that by the time it actually fully opened in 1982, it was completely and utterly unfashionable because times had moved on. But it's interesting how in the period between 1982 and now, its reputation has grown and grown. Because what did it do? It took a visionary approach to how you could create a residential estate with the arts at its core. And that is why here we have theatre and cinema and music and art galleries surrounded by a wealth of a residential estate, a girls' school, a church, etc., etc. Now, it is worth saying that when you start from scratch in those ways, you do fix what you're doing in an age which may be quite difficult to escape from. And one of the reasons why we all joke, and it's not entirely untrue, about the Barbican being inaccessible is because, in a very significant way, it is. The Barbican was built as a concept of a walled city, so it presents a very forbidding face to the outside world. But I think you'll agree, especially on a sunny day, that when you get inside to the lakeside terrace and the church and the lake, this is an absolutely fantastic urban space. But you cannot possibly know it's here unless you are in here. And that is one of the fundamental Barbican problems. Another thing, just in terms of the vision of town planning that it embodies, you may have noticed that you cannot get across to the church unless you are up on level 2 going across the bridge that goes across the lake. There is no ground floor way to navigate the lake. And the reason for that is a conscious decision at the time that everything was going to happen from the pedestrian point of view, in line with the Corbusier ideals, everything was going to happen on level two. And I puzzled about this for ages until in the front of Pevsner's guide to the architecture of the City of London, there is a plan that shows how the high walks of the Barbican were intended to link in to a complete high walk network around the city. And everybody was going to walk around on level two, and cars were going to drive through the ghastly Beach Street tunnel, and that wouldn't have been something that was used by pedestrians at all. And so you do get a bit fixed in your ways if you have that vision. And we might get on to talking about one or two of the other places in the UK that I think embody a place and time. Milton Keynes always strikes me as, you know, created with certain wonderful living aspirations in mind, but totally dominated by the dominance of the car at the time it was put together, so that it's really quite difficult to walk around. And these utopian ideas created from scratch sometimes will have great acceptance, and sometimes they won't. I was incredibly struck to go to the town of Gibellina in Sicily, where an earthquake destroyed virtually the entire town. Again, it could have been rebuilt on the site, but what they did, even more radically than the two examples we've talked about, was to invite an artist to turn the destroyed town into an artwork, and to build a completely new, adventurous, created by Italian architects, new place for living a couple of miles away. The new place for living is a disaster because nobody wants to live there. They would rather live in the ramshackle buildings and temporary buildings that were put up by their old living places. And this looks like a ghost town now, which has never really entered the bloodstream. And of course, that goes to the last point I think we ought to think about, which is, what voice do people have in the architecture within which they live? And I think this is going to be, we see it everywhere in the arts now, that the quest for participation, the quest to be part of the dialogue, and I think that's more and more true with regard to architecture. And there are some wonderful and inspiring examples around the world now of what is loosely called humanitarian-based architecture, particularly where there have been crises, floods, tsunamis, earthquakes, and the answer to those crises is to engage with the local population on what they want by way of living. And I think that's something we've got a lot to learn from.
Okay. Just to kick off, I thought I'd ask the panel a question again, as if I was Jonathan, because he's not here. I mean, the picture that Jonathan paints is of us currently living in a capitalist utopia. And that capitalist utopia is the City of London, with guys with wearing shades, looking up at the sky, and iconic buildings that have all got branded names that we all are familiar with. I'm just interested whether you recognize that idea, because basically what he's saying is utopianism is a con. It's the construction of an image of a future idea of what a place might be that can never be really recognized. It's just a con trick. It's like a capitalist advertising trick. And that's his understanding of what we have now. I'm interested to know what you think about that. Do you recognize that? Or if he was here, would you tell him he was wrong?
But I feel like a utopia needs to have both the kind of, it needs to have, well, the critique of the current find, but then it needs to propose, to be propositional in two ways, both in the kind of a model society and a model space. Mm. And I feel like when it is the capitalist utopia. These two components kind of merge into one, and right. you can't quite discern. It's kind of the space and the aesthetics of the city and that shape the kind of its contents or the kind of the society that it produces, rather than these two being two distinct starting points that that then trigger a kind of a richer okay. utopia or
right. Do you have any thoughts?
Well, I don't know if I really buy Jonathan's explanation, because I think if you look at all sorts of things, parts of the discussion today about cities and about urban planning, then I think what you find quite a lot is that it's the market that's presented as the problem for how things are going wrong. So there's not enough housing, it's because developers are running riot, they don't build, they only build to suit themselves, they have land banks and da-di-da-di-da. Or infrastructure is we leave it too much to market forces to come in and take responsibility for the state. And I just think this is a bit of a problem, because it strikes me that, and certainly in the trajectory of the last 30 years, where I suppose you could to some extent say that in the early 1980s that a more market-orientated approach did take over from what had gone on before. Certainly compared to them, it seems to me that the market hasn't really run right. It's not doing all of these things. There's a kind of failure to take responsibility in all parts of society, both amongst developers, yes, but not because they're running riot, but because they're not actually building enough. On the side of the state, not taking responsibility for the aspects that what they're providing for. So to the extent that the no-topia thesis, that I think is which is John's, where John's drawing this from, and which is Architectural Review's kind of take on the world just now, albeit with lots of different things in there. I just don't really get that. I mean, I know it goes subtopia, no-topia, and kind of the world, the market is the root of the problem. But I just think it's our lack of ambition just now, and our lack of drive, and our lack of dynamism that's the problem, not the market.
I just think Jonathan's wrong about this. I mean, he made a whimsical point about skyscrapers being brand names. They're not brand names. They're actually nicknames which have been given them by people who have reacted to the way they look. And so I think that's an expression of ownership rather than an expression of the market taking over. Of course, there are huge problems with the market, and Manon's referred to the main one, which is affordable housing. And that is a real issue now for London, which London has got to solve. But to say, as Jonathan did, a City of London skyline no longer worth having, robbed of history, culture, planning, grace, and character, I think, you know, maybe like every good journalist, he's exaggerating for effect. But I think, as I walk around the square mile of the city, it is planned and put together, considering the pressures on it, with incredible grace. And those tall buildings are really quite sensitively placed in the city within that old street plan that I was referring to. And the juxtaposition of history and heritage with the modern world in the city, I find absolutely thrilling on a daily basis. And of course, I think it represents the better side of planning and control interacting with the pressures of the marketplace. I don't think we can delude ourselves that London will ever be free of the pressures of the marketplace. It has been a mercantile city for many centuries longer than we've been here. And the thing is to keep that under control as far as we can and ensure that the best things that we want to express in the city find some way of being expressed. And I think the best architects and planners want that, don't they? They don't want to simply give over the city to rapacious developers.
Well, I mean, that's interesting, because it's almost as if you're saying, as far as imagination goes, the imagination of the capitalist class and the developers is always going to be problematic. Their vision is going to be problematic. The imagination of the planners is on the whole going to be positive and good. I mean, is that what you're saying?
No, I wasn't saying the influence of planners is always going to be positive. I was just trying to answer Jonathan that actually I think planners have done quite a reasonable job in the crowded square mile of the city to create urban environments that are not absolutely awful.
Okay. I know that Alistair wants
Well, even on the level of affordable housing, I'm not sure that the market can take the blame for that. And certainly in the way that it's quite often portrayed, which is this neoliberalism and free market has run riot. But, I mean, obviously, to some extent, there is a problem with the market in that it's not very productive, so it attracts investment. It means that housing becomes a form of investment rather than something built for occupation. So on that level, I can agree that it's a problem. But this idea that the market is running riot just seems to me to not be the case.
And
we need more development, I think. The point is we need more development, not less.
We absolutely do need more development, but why is so much high-end development being built? If you open the Sunday Times today and look at what's for sale in housing, it is all penthouse flats at the top of city blocks that have been specially created at a price of a couple of million or more.
Okay, so there's a kind of sense that I get at the moment that if we kind of are all sympathetic to utopian thinking, probably, or the ambition of utopian thinking, and there's a kind of idea that's knocking around that there was a golden age, which Piketty has told us about in his book Capital, which is somewhere sort of in the middle of the 20th century, and it definitely ended when the Berlin Wall came down, or perhaps when Thatcher came to power, or Reagan, or something. Do we want to, if we're interested in utopianism, do we just want to go back to that? Do we want to go back to the period from, 1945 to 1980, something like that? That seems to be the sort of general culture at the moment, that we're thinking that utopianism is just what happened during that period. I'm interested to know what the audience think about what's been said and where they stand on this. Can we talk about a utopianism for today that isn't based on a model that comes from about 1968?
I think it's a very good point to think about cities like Brasilia and Houston. They were conceived at a time when the car was dominant, therefore they were spread out. I think the problem you have is different views of utopia. And I was at another session, and I had someone from Friends of the Earth, and they were saying, what we need is actually denser cities because people will walk everywhere. And I thought that's very sensible. Then someone else came out and said, what we want is lots of open spaces and everything. I thought, how do you get around that? Now, you could say that, yes, there are solutions. Do we need a green belt? Possibly not. Do we want green places within? But I don't know whatever. But I mean, as a non-car driver, I want to walk everywhere. Therefore, I do want it to be fairly dense. Other people have different views. It's not the solution to try and make cities resilient, so that you don't build them and suddenly there's a change of philosophy, and if you like, they become redundant. It could be interesting. London was actually very successful, struggled when the car race. Now we're moving away from that, and it's actually becoming better again.
You've all spoken about London as if it's a capitalist society. And this is not capitalism, okay? The government owns the roads. There's the NHS. This is not freedom. This is the government running things, okay? This is what's called a mixed economy. This is not capitalism. So don't smear capitalism by associating it with a mixed economy where there's a great deal of socialism in this country. Just don't do it. That's my point.
Okay.
So to move away from the capitalism stuff, because I don't necessarily think it matters who or how things get paid for, more important is probably what's being built. I'd like to ask our panel if you think there are kind of different challenges or different values associated in trying to build a utopia that is vertical, trying to be as high as you can, or trying to build a utopia that is horizontal and that is kind of, might lend itself towards inclusivity or density, as was raised here. But what are the values or challenges that would be associated in those two different models, and do they support each other, or that kind of thing?
Okay, thank you.
I'm interested in knowing what the panel thinks about how you manage this. What you mentioned, two examples of people just wanting to build what they had before, in fact, and if their utopia is to go back home, how do we also aspire to kind of social utopia and acknowledge that?
Really enjoyed those comments from the panel. Thank you. Just in line with what you were saying about how utopias today seem to be so unambitious, pared down, depressing, let me ask a depressing question of you. Because one of the areas I've noticed, which is held out today as a kind of vision of the future and a utopia, is Silicon Valley, is what Google and Facebook and Apple are doing in building these huge campuses, these beautiful green open spaces, that this is like the future of work, where essentially work has become this like a garden center where you play games all the time and you're treated like a child. It's kind of like bedroom culture institutionalized in this new environment, which is really the privatization of community. It's going back. There's nothing new about this, which is really even more depressing. This is the old, this is Ford building towns. These are the company town. And whether you're inside or outside, to your point about the Barbican, is really what demarcates you in this world of trying to create this idyllic life and community within the walls of this new, wonderful new nirvana. Outside, there's injustice, oppression, violence, etc. And the point about this, surely, is that it just constrains human imagination and behavior because you've got to remain within the walls, which means you have to comply. It's not a free environment. It's a highly coercive one.
That's interesting. On the other hand, if you look at some of the proposals that people like Thomas Heatherwick have made for some of the employers in Silicon Valley, it is really innovative and very fascinating. So how do you sort of marry those two things, that these people are commissioning very interesting buildings? Austin.
In terms of the discussion on utopia, it's very similar to debates or comments that you often receive these days on optimism and pessimism. And people regularly kind of complain that I'm a pessimist because I sometimes think that some of the arguments people are having in political life are a bit depressing. Whereas obviously that's just a straightforward, correct observation rather than my philosophical stance. So, people are now using optimism as a philosophical kind of statement. That they want it to happen. They just feel that if they pray and think hard enough, then it will happen. But obviously, you have to be pessimistic if there's pessimism in the air. So in terms of this agenda, utopia, I find that there's, from what I read on the blurb, there's a lot of discussion on utopia. People are much more talking about it now, the Architectural Review talking about some of these ideas. And it's almost like it's a wishful thinking beyond the reality of the moment. The previous session in here on futurism was very clearly lots of young people saying how much they look to the future with dread and trepidation and fear of global warming, climate change, community breakdown, warfare, you name it, rather than some, idyllic vision of the future. So we have this strange contradiction of the reality of negative visions and negative realities as people perceive it, and yet lots of people talking about optimistic utopias. How do you square that circle?
I think it connects to a lot of the topics that have been raised, but it's essentially challenging the sustainability is only not making things worse. I think surely that bringing together the built environment with the natural environment in a way that the humans actually living in that environment are better off, that has to create some form of architectural vision, surely.
Do you want to start?
Can we go right back to the first point? Because in talking to people recently about the challenge of what you do next with London, your point about open spaces versus high rises was absolutely at the top of the discussion. And one architect said to me, you only have to fly in to Heathrow to realize that London is a city of front doors. And that is a very fundamental thing about the way we live our lives, the way we've chosen to live our lives, which is we are fixated on having individual dwellings, preferably with a garden. And the sort of ways that other great European cities have coped with large numbers, which is to have enlightened, high-quality, high-rise living, has been surprisingly absent here, probably because so much of the high-rise that was built in previous ages of planning was very poor and so acquired a really, really bad reputation. Now, there must be some halfway house in that. But I think the great planners now, for instance, if you go to Richard Rogers's cheese grater, which is a massive structure, that is based around having public open space at the bottom, linked to the St. Helens Square next door. And he would say that it ought to be possible to create an open space network right across the city, even if you are at times building above it. So I think there are ways through that, but I think you're right to identify that's the question.
I think the idea of optimism versus pessimism is slightly problematic in the sense that when we look too much at today, it feels like somehow architects can be too stuck in the kind of the current moment. And I almost tend to think that architecture should maybe do more with the past and the future rather than with the current present, because we're stuck in the current models. It's much harder to kind of tweak and reform rather than to propose something new. And of course, the problem is then how do you relate that proposition to the current situation? How do they meet in a way? But without thinking first of tomorrow rather than kind of starting from the situation we're in now, I feel like we need to have this sense of vision. And I feel like, I don't know if it's because today as a kind of young architect feel I certainly sense is that there isn't enough vision in a way from the architect's point of view. And I don't mean to say that it's just because we blame the market. I do think that the market takes hold because no one else is kind of proposing anything. And I think it's too easy to sit back and just blame the market for it. I do think we need to do something about it. And you know, I mean, architects, I guess, have to be somewhat optimistic by default. Otherwise, I think, you know, even if the project you're doing, whatever project you're doing, you have a vision for something. It could be the extension of a house, like of a kitchen. It could be anything. You're projecting something in the future, so you have to have that optimism. I think.
Yeah, the philosopher Kirsten Harris says that it's absolutely intrinsic to the discipline that you're imagining something that doesn't already exist, and therefore there's a little seed of utopianism within the discipline, which can't really be eradicated. But are you saying that it kind of has been eradicated as it stands at the moment? Even though people are projecting, they're not projecting in any meaningful way. It's just a pragmatic projection.
Yeah, it is too pragmatic, and it's too, I mean, they're too, it's too much of being the instrument of the other forces that are at play in a way, which you could also say you can't really blame the architects. Like at the end of the day, they get a kind of percentage of the construction cost, and that they, you know, need to make a living out of building something right now. They can't just sit in their studios and kind of think of a better tomorrow. No, they need to be in the now. They need to be building. They need to be making a living as well. But through the kind of, I guess, the skill set of an architect, even through the, I mean, representation, for example, is a key skill, I think. And through even just the drawing or the analysis of the current situation, you can start projecting in a way for tomorrow. And I think there should be more propositions.
I'll bring Alastair in a minute, but somebody mentioned the point, the idea of resilient cities, which is incredibly fashionable. All my colleagues are constantly using this term. Nobody really knows exactly what it means, but the implication is that we need to design cities which have a very strong sense of the passage of time. But as an idea, it's kind of saying, which is of course true, you make a plan and then you've got to build it. They're two separate things. But in making that point and talking about resilient cities, are we not sort of strangling the imaginative and visionary and ambitious element of the process, Nicholas?
Well, I think on the spectrum between optimism and pessimism that was raised here, what we look to the architects to do is to be realists and see how you can mitigate all those fears of the future that you were talking about young people having for the future, and engage with that on an intellectual level. That's where the vision comes from. All we get upset about is seeing architects who are driven purely by responding to the demands of the marketplace. Shouldn't architects be part of the pushback? Shouldn't they be part of the push towards socialism and a bit of planning in opposition to the dominance of the market?
Do you think something like the term resilient city, is that useful or problematic?
Pass. That's not my...
Right. Do you think it's useful or a bit problematic?
I think it's problematic.
Okay.
Problematic.
Problematic. Good.
What does it really mean?
The whole idea of resilience is, its starting point is that the future is a terrible place, and therefore you have to build in an element of resilience into what you do in order to withstand the forces that are going to make society cave in. So it starts from a point of view of...
Well, presumably anybody who's been affected by an earthquake or a typhoon or a tsunami would absolutely believe that to be the priority.
Well, that's right. But then I think you have to differentiate in these whole ideas of resilience that are incredibly popular just now, as Penny says, from resilience that arises in the face of a shock, right, like an earthquake, where you often find actually that people respond incredibly positively to these unforeseen situations, and they manage to organize themselves in ways that actually coheres whatever people, communities, and life moves on once again. But the idea of planning resilience, I think, is something completely different altogether. Its starting point is that the world out there is going to hell in a handcart through ecological destruction or community fragmentation or whatever problem that you want to start with and throw in. And then it says that you can go on to construct society in a way to withstand all of those shocks. So its starting point is a sense of vulnerability rather than a sense of more positive transformation.
And of being a victim rather than actually proposing something.
Yeah. Yes. Okay, in terms of the panel, the points about horizontal or vertical city, Silicon Valley, sustainability, did any of you...
Can I just come back on the Silicon Valley one? Because I recognize that. One thing I'd say in response is that if you go back through the history of utopias, you always or quite often find that inside the wall is a fairly mad set of ideas, whether it be overtly religious orders or quite authoritarian sense of how you live, or just mad or cranky ideas. I mean, utopias with, bans on sex or the crankiness is part of the visionary stuff, if that makes sense. And I suppose, I mean, in one sense, when we got to the 19th century and Engels wrote his socialism, utopian or scientific, he was arguing against that kind of mental construct of the future and saying that we now had a scientific basis for building the future. And I think they were good points to make, given what had come before with the new Lanark and the kind of utopian socialists that had tried to build society in a way that emerged out of a mental construct rather than reacting to reality. But I just think that today we're in a little bit of a different situation to then, and I think it's worthwhile allowing ourselves the space to have a bit more of an imaginative take on the future. And undoubtedly there will be crankiness in there and stuff that we don't want to see, but then we can reject those and we can critique them and you know, move to different models. So I think you're right. I think there is actually some positive stuff that's around just now about Silicon Valley as well, which we can find out about. And finally, on the optimism thing, I think that's right that we're in a moment just now where there does seem, people seem to feel the need to declare their optimism. The most astonishing one for me was when Ed Miliband in the 2010 election declared himself to be the big optimist of the, you know, all the characters involved in the election. He'd just been the energy
secretary who was telling us all that we were going to hell, you know, the world was going to end in the not too distant future. So that yeah, I think we need to take with a pinch of salt this whole idea that people are optimistic. And in terms of the more to link that to utopianism, I took a or I met with a group of students in Venice over the summer from four or five different countries and universities, and they were there to do a utopian an imagination of utopia as one of their student projects, and they were all incredibly pessimistic about Venice and saw it as all overrun by tourism and all sorts of any number of problems that they associated with contemporary Venice. But they all declared themselves optimists as well. And one of the ways that they found of doing that was that they did these projects which developed some sort of way out of the overly, what they saw as the overt dominance of tourism. So they weren't particularly ambitious or transformative projects. They were just ways that people within Venice could find a way of escaping from these hordes of tourists. And that was then sold as this kind of optimistic take on creating a new Venice of the future. So I think, you know, there is this tendency to want to be optimistic, but within that, there's no sense of a general sort of positive transformation that's on offer.
But why is that? Is that because we find it difficult to come up with real new ideas? Is that because we feel that everything's been done, or is that because there's an overload of information, you know, even on the internet, and then you feel like everything's been tried, everything's been done? Why?
Well, I think there was an unwillingness to take a leap into the imaginative realm, actually. And I suppose that, to some extent, is a hangover from the latter half of the 20th century, when the whole idea of utopia became discredited because those places that were built, that were associated with utopia, were people's critique of them started to be so negative. You know, utopianism was associated at worst with sort of communist experiments and totalitarianism. So that very idea that you can take a leap and then try and construct according to that imaginative belief is seen as a problem in and of itself.
Maybe it's because there's too much pressure and we should almost kind of detach it from the pressure of responding to the present and bring in a bit more fiction. And it was Constant in The New Babylon who'd said, it's incredibly tricky to describe something like that. He was talking about a day in the life of New Babylon before it actually exists. In fact, you can only really talk about it in a negative sense about what New Babylon is not. Because otherwise there's just, I don't know, it becomes too much for the human brain to actually come up with something that you kill it before it's born in a way, right? Like you're already destroying the potential imaginary view before you allow it to be born. Because it's very easy to say that in the 60s this was kind of escapism and, you know, what it actually did for architecture. But at least they were trying something, at least they were trying to come up with a solution. You know, you can criticize it once it's born and drawn, but right now it's not really drawn yet.
So you're saying there should be two realms, one that's imaginative and visionary and unrestricted by reality in any way, and then a pragmatic realm.
Is that? Yeah, I guess.
Okay. I mean, I'm interested in what the audience think about this and what Alistair thinks, but I'm going to give the audience a bit chance to come in.
I suppose my question is, is ambition and vision inevitably going to be tempered by buy-in?
Tempered by what?
Getting the buy-in. So if there was somebody who came up with a great vision.
Yeah, I was beginning to get a bit depressed by the conversation at the moment. So I think the great thing about utopianism is that, you know, it does enable thinking of a universal nature, a great ambition, and a sense of possibilities and opening up of possibilities with imagination. So that's really my view of what the usefulness of a utopianism is, because without that, we will never get someone to build a brick on a brick. And I really mean that, because you can pay someone to put a brick on a brick, but to do it in a planned way requires of what you were saying about the kernel of utopianism in every architectural or planning design is right, because you've got to inspire. Someone's got to have a sense of inspiration, a sense of involvement, be it the constructor, be it the community in which it's being constructed, whatever, for it to happen. Because change and development is a painful process. It's not something we just do out of, or most of us don't do it out of any particular pleasure. We need that sort of utopian sense of vision. Now, in terms of this concept of fortress-like imagination, that's really where I think where that comes in is where people are creating utopias, thinking, imagining utopias, and can only do so, because the human brain, I think, can only do so within limits and constraints. So it'd be interesting, I mean, the architect for Barbican is no longer with us, so it'd be interesting to know whether that sort of construct of the fortress, the walled fortress, was something that that was felt to be necessary in order to provide the constraint to drive the vision and nature of what became the Barbican. But whatever, all that thinking has got to be have a sense of the possible and achievement in making that possible real.
I'm young, and as a millennial, which is a group of people that has been spoken about a lot during this weekend, it's been a topic of a lot of conversations. I'm optimistic, but in a different way to those students in Venice, I'm optimistic about now. And much like Johan Norborg at the Cato Institute, I do actually feel like we are living in a golden age in a way, and that we dread a great deal, yet when I take the Docklands Light Railway through to the brand new residential development down by the Thames Barrier, where I've been staying over the weekend, and I go past Canary Wharf, I'm actually filled with a great sense of aspiration. I see gleaming towers stretching up into the sky, and it makes me feel like I want to achieve, and I want to achieve what has been achieved there. Now, my girlfriend's granddad was the chief structural engineer for the Barbican when it was being built. And when I'm here, no offense to this place, but I feel no such hope and no such aspiration. It feels like the architecture of post-war British socialism penning me in and trying to guide the way my life ought to be. It feels like the utopianism of these Keynesianists in Britain in that era. That is the era which would have given me the greatest dread and greatest pessimism. So, I know Jonathan isn't here, but if this is a capitalist utopia, and it isn't quite, unfortunately, it is one which is giving me a great sense of aspiration and a great sense of hope. Thank you.
Hi. I find the whole HSBC and the Canary Wharf tends to hem me in quite significantly as a resident of London. That's my comment on the last speaker. And I think it neglects also the way in which London, being the mercantile capital of the world, its history, it's the historical debt we have in relation to the slave trade, which helped build this city. And there's no mention of that, the historical debt which we have to the rest of the world. And so without that recognition, there can be no positive future, and will be a pessimistic future unless we take account of our history, we pay our debt, and we develop and we work together as a world for a better future.
Okay. It strikes me that the utopian project is always a political one. You look at past literary examples. I think of William Morris's historical romantic vision of a kind of pre-industrial Britain is a socialist vision. To kind of go on from what Manon was maybe saying, that we live now in a society of no ideologies, no real politicalness. Maybe that's the challenge we're facing now, and we can't really find our utopia anymore.
Well, we've talked a lot about buildings as being the kind of primary source of utopia. I know you were saying, Manon, about how maybe architects don't feel like they have the necessary tools or whatever it is to really think big in other ways. And I think, you know, it's interesting to talk about the Barbican. Unlike some of the other examples, it has a school and it has a church and it has an arts centre. And I just think it's interesting that we've kind of not really dreamt about how our education system should, for example, be pushing towards a utopian vision. And I think part of that is because buildings, obviously there is ideology within them, but once they're built, they're kind of static and they're fixed, whereas education is a battlefield every day, and there's more ideas at play just all the time, you know? So I think it's just interesting that we kind of think that we can build the utopia and then the people will behave in a certain way, but actually, really, most of the things which will lead people to behave in different ways are taking place outside of architecture or building.
The thing I want to come back to that people seem to be dismissive of, and I wonder why, is the word sustainability, because obviously it's something that we're sort of pushing towards in lots of different fields, and I know maybe it does make us pessimistic about the future that we have to be resilient, but the lady here mentioned it as well. Why is it that that isn't something that's intriguing you as a visionary of the future to say, let me grasp this idea that, I'm not talking about necessarily environmental sustainability, although I think it comes into it, but social sustainability. So the gentleman who got a kick out of going through, you know, Canary Wharf, I live in South East London, and I see that as a real division. It's gentrification at its worst. Like, you know, in Peckham at the moment, oh, we've got a car park that's now an arts centre and a bar, but no one can afford to live near it, hurrah. So, you know, these social issues that then come in the space. So I think sustainability, I really would like somebody to answer it because two people have asked now and I'd like someone to take it.
Okay. I'm kind of actually about the sustainability of utopia, but going back to that initial definition by Thomas More, the no place and perfect place simultaneously. Is it that, I think Alistair kind of mentioned that utopia has to be flexible and be able to adapt over time, but is it more just that utopia can only ever exist in that moment of not quite existing yet? It's always kind of like that idea, and that we cannot sustain any one utopia, any built form of utopia for any period of time, and that it always has to remain just the idea.
I'm perfectly okay about visions of utopia that are extremely ambitious and visionary, but they have got to take account of how people are and how people behave. And so one subject that's come up is Silicon Valley. Are we culturally a Silicon Valley society? Are our young people going to want to organise themselves from the point of view of jobs and offices and living in that sort of way? That is a big, big question. And people change, and people are changing faster than ever from generation to generation. And your excellent point at the back that one of the things you feel about the Barbican is being penned in is because it was built as an enclosed community. If it was inspired by anything, it was inspired by Italian hill towns with walls around them. And the sense that this was for the people who lived inside is a very powerful one, which is also common across a lot of the arts. If you go to the great opera houses of the world, the great municipal theatres, those are things for people who belong in there and feel that they have the privilege to be part of that community, but they are not open to the world. And so you go around all the arts organisations of London these days and they are busy opening their buildings up. Even the Opera House, the National Theatre, they're all busy rebuilding the front of their buildings so that people can actually feel welcome and feel part of it. So all I'm saying there is that the difficulty with having a utopian vision for the future is that when you get to the future, it may no longer be the right vision. And that's why I do think you have got to be adjustable. And to come back to your point, yes, it is about buy-in. It is about consent. And I think that if you can go with people and take people with you for all the agonies of consultation, it is an extremely good way of moving forward. And allow different methods to flourish of creating this future at different times. I went down to Southeast London and just at Honor Oak Park, there is a whole little community of self-built houses on land
provided by Lewisham because they couldn't think of anything else to do with it. It was very hilly and awkward. And so a community has established itself there and is ready, if it can get the right legal agreements with the council for the future, to take that work further. And I think that is a really good balancing act with the great skyscrapers which are creating some of the wealth which enables all this to happen.
To start maybe on the environmental system sustainability, I struggle to see what vision there really is when we talk about environmental sustainable building and zero carbon footprint. And I agree that it's a concern, and I agree that it's a technical aspect of the construction industry and that architects should take it into account. But I don't feel that it's enough as an ideology, as a vision, as a proposition. I don't think it should be ignored. And social sustainability, yes, is very important. And I think that's also where we hit the kind of the limits of the discipline, in the sense that architects do their bit, but to go back on your point, they can't, you know, Utopia is not to be designed only by architects and it's not reliant only on them. I think they have to do their bit of the job. I think this is where the idea of kind of projecting into the future, the idea of fiction comes in and is important, because it's not that it's the answer to everything. It's not that that projected vision is going to be a solution, and that, as yeah, I agree, otherwise it would be kind of stuck in its own time and it needs to adapt. But we need a sort of a starting point. We need a vision to then build upon, to then question, to then, if we had more solutions than, if we had more, yeah, solutions rather than answers, would be in a terrible place in a way. But right now we don't really have a starting point to kind of ask questions. And I think the idea that architects can solve the refugee crisis and stop global warming is slightly ridiculous. I think that just goes completely beyond the discipline. And is that why we're left not knowing where to even start? I think architects should do their bit of the job. Which I'm not saying they're doing now, I'm one of them, but there are other people at stake, and the utopias can't be just born on a kind of the architect's drawing board. There's more to it.
Okay. Are you saying it's a political problem or an architectural problem? The lack of vision, predominantly?
It's probably both, but someone needs to take the first step, and I guess architects could. So it's probably architectural first.
Okay. Alastair.
Well, I thought the point at the back was quite good, actually, and quite useful. Because I mean, I don't buy it, actually, that the Barbican is a utopian project. I think it's just a good design solution to a site that existed at a certain period of time. So that, to me, is not really utopian. I think utopia much more gets at what was said at the back, because I think there's a freer, more imaginative realm within utopian thinking that's not just about creating a good design solution to a pre-existing problem or pre-existing site. I think in many ways, perhaps one of the reasons why we kind of think of utopian thinking as in that form is because we almost delight in the constraints of a site these days, because it means that we can't go further than the site. The vision can't be too big. And this point of do we need to bring more fiction? Do we need to have a kind of alternative fictional reality? I mean, I think the problem with this just now, and this kind of goes back to the resilience point again that we were mentioning earlier, is that as soon as you set the imagination free, then it's invariably drawn towards a kind of apocalyptic imagination. That's the condition that we're in just now, because there's something called that's been quite popular in certainly in urban planning and I think other design professions in recent years, which is called scenario planning, which is long-term forecasting within planning at 10, 20, 40 years. And I was vaguely involved in a project a few years ago, which was about the scenario planning of airports. And the problem with it was that it wasn't just a kind of objective look at the future as to how you could plan for the future airport capacity. It was one which built in all these fundamentally, well, almost apocalyptic scenarios, actually, about what climate change would do in the future, and therefore the future of airport
port capacity had to respond to these kind of apocalyptic scenarios. So it wasn't a particularly positive or productive process. And I just think the place we're at is that we have an ingrained sense of vulnerability just now. And as long as we, and this is where I kind of differ on the environmental, the sustainability thing, because to me, if we have a kind of ingrained sense of that humanity is a plague on the planet, if you like, that we're, you know, that mankind is no more than carbon-emitting, nature-wrecking sort of thing that inhabits the planet, then we will never be able to set the imagination free in a particularly positive sense, or certainly not in any sort of it'll just be bit part thinking. So for me, the starting point in all of this to recover a sense of a more worthwhile imagination of the future is challenging this idea that humanity is the problem, and actually starting to see ourselves as the solution. So for me, it's a political project first, and can only then be a worthwhile architectural project after we win that political battle. And just to finish with, I kind of disagree with Nick, I think, because I just think that all of this kind of need to be inclusive about everything is a little bit of a problem just now, because you just go around, it becomes a lowest common denominator output from all of this. And I think it reflects our nervousness about putting forward propositions and putting our neck on the line a little bit and taking a chance. And I think we need to do that. And it would be a positive move if we did that. And that's the way we could recover something more worthwhile.
Good. Okay, can we put our hands together, please?